Very good afternoon to all of you. On behalf of Sri Lanka Medical Association, I welcome all of you for this very important session on novel coronavirus infection. Are we ready to face it? First of all, I would like to very briefly explain why, as Sri Lanka Medical Association, we wanted to organize this symposium. As you are well aware, the novel coronavirus infection was first detected in Wuhan, China. That was in December 2019. And the first case in Sri Lanka was reported only last week. And this being a new virus, a lot of uncertainty around that. And because of that, there are a lot of misinformation and miscommunication happening. So we thought this is a very serious moment, disinformation. So as the apex medical body of the medical profession in the country, and as the organization who is working in collaboration with all the stakeholders related to Sri Lanka, we are in the best position to collaborate with all the organizations and to bring them together so that we can clearly come out with what are the clear and simple messages and to make sure that as a country, we are facing this situation. And I would like to thank all of you for attending this very important session. I can see large numbers come in, and we are communicating and sharing this information through a webinar as well, where again, a lot of doctors are participating. And I would like to thank the SLMA Expert Committee on Communicable Diseases and the Media Committee for organizing this. And also we have the media presence here. I'd like to thank all of you for coming here because it's very important that we get the very clear and simple message to be communicated to the general public. So on behalf of the Sri Lanka Medical Association, I thank all the media and the institutions for your support that is given to us. So without further ado, we'll start with a symposium. The first presentation is about virological diagnosis and aspect of novel coronavirus. And our resource person is Dr. Saranga Sumathipala, who is a consultant virologist from the Teaching Hospital, Anuradhapura. Over to Saranga.
Thank you very much. I wish to express my thanks to the Sri Lanka Medical Association for inviting me for this speech. In the next few minutes, I will be talking about the virology and the laboratory diagnosis of the 2019 novel coronavirus. Okay, this story, as we know, it starts around 12th of December 2019 in Wuhan city of China, with the hospital admission of individuals with severe acute respiratory illness. Later, it was found that most of them were working or had visited local open seafood market. In the days followed by, the numbers of such cases increased exponentially, with deaths being reported. The WHO was informed by 31st of December 2019, and the Chinese scientific community was able to identify coronavirus, which was never seen before anywhere. And it has sequence homology to SARS virus by 79.5%. And this new virus was provisionally named the 2019 novel coronavirus, or some people call it the Wuhan novel coronavirus. And soon, imported cases of this novel coronavirus started to appear in other countries as well. As of 29th of January, yesterday, WHO official data shows that the infection has been reported in 16 countries, including China, with 6,065 confirmed cases and 132 deaths. But yesterday, unofficially, got somewhere around 8,000 the numbers of patients. Sri Lanka is among these countries. So, a coronavirus. Coronavirus belong to a group of large viruses, which are ubiquitous in the world. Okay. And if you look at this virus, if you look at this virus, and positive sense RNA nucleocapsid covered by a lipid membrane, glycoprotein structures can be observed. And these spikes give the coronavirus an appearance of a halo or crown, which the name corona was derived from. These viruses attach to host cells via several receptors, specifically the angiotensin converting enzyme to the S2 receptor is the receptor of the host in the SARS-related viruses. There are other receptors as well. And this virus replicates and forms new viruses via viral RNA-dependent RNA polymerase in the host cell. If we consider the diversity of these coronaviruses, they are broadly divided into four groups as alpha, beta, gamma, and delta coronaviruses based on their relatedness of the genetic sequences. In humans, there are four coronaviruses in circulation, namely human coronavirus 229E, OC43, NA63, and HKU1. We have actually detected these things in our circulation as well in our country. And in fact, these coronaviruses are not in the spotlight as serious causes of illnesses until the discovery of the SARS coronavirus in 2002. Similarly, a second pathogenic coronavirus, which is the MERS coronavirus, was identified in 2012. Yeah. And coronaviruses can infect many vertebrates, animal species, including mammals and birds. And bats are considered the major reservoir in the wild. And from time to time, mutations which occur in these viruses permit them to infect other animal species. And humans can get these introductions of these zoonotic viruses, either via direct bat exposure or indirectly via secondary animal, where the virus transits to the secondary animal species. And the secondary animal actually must have got this infection mainly from the bats. And human interactions could be due to contact of urine, feces, and other secretions of animals, or by consumption of raw undercooked contaminated animal products, which generally can be seen in practices like food practices like the countries like China. Okay, and as far as the 2019 the novel coronavirus is concerned, the host or the source of this virus, the host is not identified yet, but there have been some publications. You know, people say it comes from snakes, but they have again analyzed these the data available, the sequences, and it is suggestive that this is most probably from a bat species. And when the human cases of this novel coronavirus is considered, the transmission is via the respiratory route, where respiratory secretions of the infected individual can transmit the virus to an uninfected person, either directly via respiratory droplets or indirectly via contact of contaminated surfaces. When this direct respiratory droplet transmission is considered, that large droplets rather than airborne virus, small particles contribute to transmission. However, since the scientific knowledge of this novel virus infection is still at its early stage, it is recommended to follow airborne precautions, especially close contacts or during close contacts of these infected people. Current available data suggests that the incubation period or the time duration from infection to clinical disease is between 2 to 14 days. The knowledge about this except pathogenesis of this is limited actually, so we don't know much about the pathogenesis of this virus, but by looking at the pathogenesis profiles of SARS and MERS and the clinical data, we can assume that the pathogenesis is more or less the same. The clinical features of the novel coronavirus is similar to other respiratory virus infections such as influenza. And studies published show that fever, cough, difficulty in breathing is common in patients who sought hospital admission. By looking at the available data, it is suggested that the disease complications and deaths are higher in the population such as elderly. and groups with other pre-existing chronic conditions such as heart disease, lung disease, and renal disease, etc. And also, it suggested that the 2019 novel coronavirus is a milder pathogen than SARS and MERS. Because if you look at the case fatality data, but it's too early to comment. In MERS, somewhere around 30-40%. In SARS, it's like around 10%. So this is very less. I mean, this is lesser than these those two. Now, at the moment, it revolves around 2%, 3%. But I think when the real data comes up, it might probably go down. There could be a population of asymptomatic, mildly symptomatic patients and who never sought medical treatment, and they may contribute this to lower numbers even. However, at present, the infected rate of this novel virus is apparently higher if you look at the other two viruses. Yeah, sorry about that. I think the computer is just frozen for the time being. Now let's consider the laboratory diagnosis of this infection, which can be used to say precisely whether someone has or has not been infected. So unlike previous times, the modern world is equipped with new technologies to identify new infections. And despite novel coronavirus being a brand new virus with no regular diagnostic means, the global scientific community quickly started designing new specific test assays for this virus within a very short time period. This is significant. Using the viral genetic sequences, data published by these Chinese scientists. So such endeavor would not have been possible about a decade ago, if you consider that about a decade ago, because we did not have some technologies at a large extent, like such as NGS next gen sequencing and this computational biology techniques, which made this possible. So at present in Sri Lanka, the virology team led by Dr. Jayama at MRI have obtained these protocols and reagents for specific testing of this virus, and he's conducting that at MRI at the moment. And if need arises, it is planned to scale up the diagnostics capacity to the regional virology laboratories of the country to fulfill the test demand. Yeah. All patients who are to be tested should fulfill specific clinical criteria. So what's shown in this slide is a section of the interim guidelines, which was published by the Ministry of Health, which gives a provisional guidance on selection of patients for testing. A patient should have clinical features of the disease, plus an epidemiological link to someone infected with the virus in order to qualify for the laboratory diagnosis. When collecting a sample for this 2019 novel coronavirus, the health staff must wear adequate person protective equipment with the, which includes contact and airborne precautions. A respiratory tract sample is obtained and collected into the specialized container tube with a medium called the VTM, viral transport medium, which is used to stabilize the virus which may be present. And the collected sample should be maintained at lower temperatures, 228 centigrade, to minimize sample degradation, and should be sent for testing within 48 hours. The specified triple packaging, there's a requirement of a triple packaging to ensure biosafety and integrity of the sample. Yeah. The test assay currently available is a laboratory developed in-house RT-PCR assay, and with time it is anticipated that commercial tests would be available. This assay can specifically detect and differentiate 2019 novel coronavirus from other known viruses by amplifying and visualizing the specific genetic region of the 2019 novel coronavirus. This can be this test can be used to detect the infection in the patient. I mean, if a patient who is suspected to have infection, we can detect the virus, as well as we can use this for monitoring of patient, for example, to ensure the virus has the virus shedding has stopped before discharging the patient. Yeah, let me briefly talk about disinfection and infection control for this virus. Since this is a respiratory virus, it is recommended that healthcare workers constantly adhere to standard precautions, contact precautions, droplet precautions, and airborne precautions whenever necessary. Proper hand hygiene practices are very important. They are a very important step in prevention of acquiring and transmission of the respiratory viral infections. Generally speaking, proper hand hygiene is better. Best option in preventing a respiratory tract infection. And since this is an envelope virus, it is highly susceptible to many disinfectant agents, including detergents and alcohol-based disinfectants. And in this slide, you can clearly see and compare the susceptibility of this pathogen with other non-infectious agents. In fact, envelope viruses are the most susceptible and most unstable infectious agents in the free environment. So, I mean, at the moment, you can observe a mass panic and you can see they are very susceptible organisms to this infection. And if we consider the environmental stability of this virus, there are no available data yet. However, we have data for similar viruses such as SARS and MERS. And they have been shown to be stable in body secretions in the environment for up to 1 to 2 days in cold and dry environments. And in China currently, they are having winter. So this cold environment may be facilitating the transmission. And if you consider our climate, it's a hot and a humid climate. So probably, transmission may be not that facilitated in the environment. So that's another plus point for us. Anyway, this is this statement is that should be backed by proper scientific evidence. Okay, thank you very much. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Dr. Saranga, for that very important presentation and enlightening us on the virological aspect. Now we have a very important presenter, Dr. Sudhas Samaravira, who is the chief epidemiologist of the Ministry of Health, and he'll be talking about the epidemiological aspect and the steps taken by the epidemiology unit. Over to you, Dr. Samaravira.
Good afternoon, everybody. That I will brief about the global situation. I think most of the things you must have known already, and the previous presenter has touched some of that. If you go to the timeline, on December 31st, the Chinese authorities has informed that they are encountering with pneumonia with unknown etiology. And the National Health Commission, China, informed that outbreak is associated with exposure to one seafood and animal market, and they have closed on January 1st. They have closed this market for the sales and the sales. On January 7th, they could identify this is coronavirus, and it is named as 2019 novel coronavirus. And January 11th. The first death reported because of this illness. January 12th, the virus was named as 12 NCOV, and the the gene sequence was shared with the global community. On January 13th, the first exported case reported in Thailand, and the, by 16th, first case in Japan reported, then the, by 19th, in the South Korea, as well as that evidence of transmission within the country has been shown. By January 20th, the healthcare workers were affected, and the suggestive of that this is transmitted among the individuals. And by January 25th, they have closed, 23rd, they have closed the Wuhan city for human mobility. The number of cases that are reported are gradually increasing, and that it is in a fast rate that it has been that the confirmed cases are increasing, and the majority are within the China, and only a few cases are reported in other countries. This is the daily report that what we got available in the web data. And this has shown that where that there has been spread that China and Southeast Asian countries, as well as the faraway countries like Canada, then United States, Australia, Japan, these cases are reported. And the thing is, the majority of these cases are that is reported from outside China are mainly that they are having a link with the Wuhan city, that who are coming from the Wuhan city are the majority of those people, and a few cases are there that has been had the close contact with the confirmed case. This is the frequency of case reporting. The most number of cases reported outside China is in Thailand, is 14 number of cases. And in addition, Japan, that are 7 cases, Korea, 4 cases, Vietnam, 2, Singapore and Australia, 7 each, Malaysia, 4 cases, Cambodia, 1, Nepal, 1, Sri Lanka, 1 case, USA, 5, Canada, 3 cases, France, 4, Germany, 4, and United Arab Emirates, again, 4 cases. This is a bit of a curve of confirmed cases report outside China, that you can see that towards the that end of the January, last 2 weeks of the January, that most of the cases are reported outside of the China, so that and that we also, the Sri Lanka also fallen in this category, and that we could expect that more and more cases may report from other countries, maybe as well in Sri Lanka. When you come into the Sri Lanka on the January 24th, the first suspected case was admitted to the infectious disease hospital, Angoda. On January 15th and the January 25th, two Chinese nationals were admitted. There's two incidents, not that simultaneously, and that with the complaint of fever and respiratory symptoms. Both are in early 40s. That the PCR test became positive, and for the novel coronavirus, this is a 43 years old female. And the January 30th, the out of the total samples of 12, that's 11 samples were negative. That's samples of 11 patients are negative and samples of one patient is positive. At the moment, I think that about 16 patients, suspected patients are in hospital under investigation and treatment. There's an early publication in the Lancet, that's the one from Van et al, comparing that this novel coronavirus with SARS and MERS. And this shows that I think that is too early to have for a definite comparison, but still that it will give some idea that how that this virus has differently behaved, that the male-female ratio is 2.7:1 in our coronavirus when it is come to MERS, 3.3:1 and 1.1 to 1.125 in SARS. The age range is, mean age is 49 among the novel coronavirus. MERS is 56 and 39.9 in SARS. And this age range in the current is 21 to 76. The confirmed cases are now it is changing at the moment. This is the published in on 24th January. So because of that, now this is again change. So still changing. The mortality wise, that it is 2.9% that among this first 41 cases of this this novel coronavirus. When you compare with the in the MERS, it is 37% and the SARS it is 10%. And the healthcare workers, this categories that has infected number of 16 cases infected by 24th January here, and MERS it is 9.8% and in SARS 23%. The symptom wise, that a fever that has in 98% of cases, dry cough 76%, dyspnea 55%, diarrhea 3% only one case, and no sore throat in here. And ventilatory support 9.8% required the ventilatory support. Those are the comparison. And the problems unresolved is that what that remaining that still to be of the disease still that suspicious is there, as the previous speaker told that it is maybe that bats and snakes, but still that is not that confirmed. The duration of transmission in humans also that is still that we don't know exactly. The ability to infect the other animal hosts is still at dark. Pathogenesis of the human infection and the quantification of subclinical and asymptomatic infections, risk factors for infection among the healthcare workers, etc. These are still that problems that is being faced by the people that medical community to answer. When you come into the Sri Lanka, that it told that one that Chinese national is infected. There's no other cases. There are so many that suspected cases. Most of the suspected cases are out of fear. It is they don't fall within the epidemiological surveillance case definition. Out of the fear, they got admitted. So some of the patients, I think Dr. Ananda will tell you that they were discharged on the same day because they are not filling the criteria. So anyway, that now that in the community there is that a certain discussion or arguments going on that what should we do to contain this or the control this or the prevent the introduction of this disease into the country. So that the thing is that we are facing two main things. I told earlier that most of the cases that introduced in other countries that are directly having the link with the Wuhan city, and they are coming, almost all the cases are coming from China. So then facing the problem, what we do about the people coming from China. There are three main categories that we can see that the people coming from China. One, people are the our own Sri Lankans who are studying there and returning because of that and because of the vacations. The second category is that the Chinese workers that who are working here, that they are gone for the holidays and they are returning that for work back. The third category are the tourists that they are coming, that there is large number of tourists has come, that we have identified that many people from Wuhan city before that it is been closed, that people came here. And now that risk is there, not there, but still that from other cities that there are most many people are coming. So there are some to be allowing them to come back, ask them to be remaining there. So that I think that according to the international norms and regulations and also the human rights of the this human mobility and movements at this moment with the evidences of this disease and this communicability and the spread of the disease, that we are taking the best decisions, that out of that the health ministry has taken several decisions. And those are the things. That one thing is the on-arrival visa to the Chinese tourists has stopped, to restrict that they are, that or discourage them coming here at this moment. The second thing is that in the airport there are some screening going on. First thing is on board there will be an announcement to the people that if they are having the run, that there's a symptom suggestive of this disease, to report to the health desk. The other thing is the thermal scanners, just to identify the people who have been running fever, but still that many people can escape that, as well as because the incubation period is 2 to 10 days, the within 14 days that people who are coming that maybe that are developing the disease here, that even though they are asymptomatic at the time of coming to the country. So the other thing is that there is a separate area or separate terminal in the airport to these flights coming from China, so then that a better screening can be done, and better all the people that who are coming from these flights, that they have to complete the health declaration form. They are you are asking about the symptoms as well as that they are whereabouts, where will be the station in the country. So that at least we give us to some extent of information for them to trace back if it is necessary. Then about especially these students and the Chinese workers, what we have done is that we are getting the information, gathering the information on arrival, as well as for the Chinese workers through our medical offices of health, that they are visiting these places and getting the information. And we have asked the regional epidemiologist and the medical officers of health that we are sharing all this information about the Sri Lankan students and the Chinese workers. They have to go to visit to these places and homes and follow up until 2 weeks time, whether they are getting the symptoms. And if they are getting symptoms, they will be getting admitted to the identified hospital. The main hospital is the National Infectious Disease Hospital, Angoda. In addition to that, 12 other hospitals, at least one in province, we have identified if it is necessary to admit these patients and to investigate and treat. And that is the one thing that we are doing. The other thing is that the students that who are trapped in the Wuhan, that the people that who are coming, Wuhan has the direct link with most of these cases. So because of that, the Minister of Health has taken a decision with the discussion with other authorities to retain these people for 2 weeks at a facility at Deotalava military base, and to watch them for 2 weeks to ensure that they are not getting these symptoms or getting this illness. If they are getting that, they will be treated. Otherwise, after 2 weeks' time, they will be discharged or they allow them to go home. So that is the scenario. That is the main thing that we are doing. And in addition to that, behind that, we are doing many things. And there are scare that because of the out of the scare, that actually that we have to counteract rather than the disease and the transmission, that to counteract this panic situation, that people are wearing masks that are going on in the community, that even that it is not been introduced, or we don't have any evidence that the disease is spreading in the community, that people are wearing masks irrationally, and that parents are giving telephone calls and asking us whether to send their children school, and some parents from the international schools and calling us and asking us that there are some Chinese students there. So that our children should send home. And then we advise that they ask us, can you assure that our children will not get the disease? So some that's difficult to answer questions. So likewise, there are so many things, even that I think the villagers in the IDH area had some get panicked and some agitated against the hospital. And even that we can see that in the Badullo hospital, that some statements going on that they are not having the facilities to encounter that entertain these patients. So because of that, it is a unwise decision taking the decision to take these people to Deotalava. So many of these things that we have to counteract. I think that as the learned medical that faculty, I think you can do a very big role here to pacify these things and also to give the positive feedback to the community as well as to our own medical and health personnel. I think that your support, we expect that your support will be received here. And thank you very much for this opportunity to Professor Indika and that SLMA to share this information. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Siddharth Samaravira, for clarifying many of the concerns and issues. And one of the main objectives of this symposium is to correct some of the misinformation and miscommunication. Now we are inviting another very important resource person to speak. And Dr. Ananda Vijay Vikram is a consult physician from the National Institute of Infectious Diseases. Over to you, Dr. Ananda.
Thank you very much. First, I would like to thank the SLMA for organizing this seminar and the importance of which is obvious with the crowd here. So I thank you very much. On the other hand, I'm sorry that probably most likely I will not be able to live up to your expectations because my knowledge is very poor on this. But on the other hand, I'm happy that because your knowledge is also poor on this. on the other hand, we have very limited data. So a lot of the things which I was planning to tell you have been already told. Anyway, so we know most coronavirus infections in humans are mild infections. However, over the last two decades, we saw two serious infections caused by variants of coronavirus, which were already mentioned, which are SARS and the MERS corona infections. If you get the total number, more than 10,000 cumulative cases had been reported due to these two viruses. And as mentioned earlier, the mortality rate was about 10% in SARS, whereas it was about 37% with MERS, which is a very high mortality rate. But fortunately, the SARS infection or the outbreak died, had a natural death. Still, we see patients with MERS infection, and fortunately, we haven't had any patients, to our knowledge, in Sri Lanka. The important good thing is with that MERS is the infectivity is quite low. So that's why even though it is continuing, we don't see many patients with that. As I mentioned earlier, the first case was diagnosed due to the following investigations done of a series of patients presented in Wuhan with a picture of viral pneumonia. And then they analyzed and found this the variants of coronavirus, which is termed as the novel corona 2019. It has a wide range of symptoms, which are already discussed, which is already shown, and most seem to have mild disease. And from the available data, it says about 20% appears to progress to severe disease, including pneumonia, respiratory failure, and in some cases, death. Unfortunately, as we all know, what is highlighted in media and probably by the Chinese authorities are also the deaths and the numbers. And when we go through this this presentation, this shown earlier, the article published in Lancet a few days ago is the first study done on this, where they have studied 41 patients, and it is a very good article, even though the number is small, and they have analyzed the symptomatology and many other things. So as just already told, the most of them had almost all had fever, cough was the next symptom, and the myalgia and fatigue, and the sputum production was in there in 28%. Only 3 had headache. Hemoptysis was there in only 5%, and 1 patient had diarrhea. The table they put there, where they showed this in 3 groups. This is the total number of patients. This is the total number of patients, and this is the patients who were admitted to ICU, and this is the patients who did not who were not admitted to ICU. So these are the symptoms, and as you can see, the most of them had cough, and then myalgia, sputum production, and other symptoms they have analyzed. The important feature they have highlighted in this is this: the from the day of onset of fever, they have put this chart, which gives very interesting information. Now, the mean day of admission of these patients is the day 7 of illness from the onset of symptomatology. So they have been having this illness for 7 days, and maybe they sought medical attention, but they got admitted on day 7, which means the condition got worse or necessitated admission around that time. And then the mean day of developing dyspnea is day 8. And then the mean day of developing acute respiratory distress is day 9. And the intensive care, again, the mean day was day 10 and a half. So which shows that they develop all these things in the latter part of the, after 7 days, basically. All these have happened after 7 days. So whether this is due to a primary viral infection or immunological mechanism or due to secondary infections, we don't know still. All those are possible. So again, the same things, the median duration of illness to onset of dyspnea was 8 days, median time of onset to symptoms of first admission was 7 days. To mechanical ventilation was 10.5 days, and similar the ICU admission. And other interesting thing is the range of this is 8 to 14 days to develop ARDS. So these are very interesting findings, I thought. In contrast, generally what we see in influenza is usually people get develop severe illness or real symptomatic illness around day 5-6. Earlier than this. The radiological changes shown by the CT scans were out of 41, 40 patients had bilateral involvement. The typical findings in the ICU admitted patients were the bilateral multilobe and subsegmental areas of consolidation. In non-ICU patients, they showed bilateral ground glass opacity with subsegmental areas of consolidation. So maybe similar. And in some patients later, we showed bilateral ground glass opacities. The management, when you come to management, again, the knowledge we have is very little. What is recommended is the early recognition, immediate isolation, then implementation of appropriate infection prevention and control measures, and the provision of optimized supportive care. They have started a trial doing using lopinavir and ritonavir, which are antivirals used for HIV infections. The reason for using that is there had been a trial using it for MERS corona in Middle East, and there had been some success with that. And that is the reason they have started, that they are at the moment they are doing the trial according to this article. So maybe there's some effect on that. And most of these patients were out of these 41 patients, most of them were started on oseltamivir and then broad spectrum antibiotics, but still the mortality rate was quite high. Day before yesterday, some of us got together, some physicians and microbiologists got together and drafted interim criteria for admissions. Some of Sahir, Dr. Priyankara, Dr. Amita, Malika, and Savani, some of the group is here, and I'm thankful to all of them for contributing to this, still at the draft form, but we won't finalize within today or tomorrow, and to give it to the ministry because we thought we have to consider the main thing we considered when making this draft guideline is to consider this virus. Well, we don't know, basically we don't know how it behaves. So therefore, at present, we thought we should take maximum possible precautions. So it is with that in mind, we prepared these guidelines. And also when making these guidelines, we went through the WHO guideline, the UK guideline, and the CDC guideline. So this is the criteria we are proposing to use. The patient presents with acute respiratory infection with the fever, sore throat, shortness of breath, and either coming from China within 14 days before the onset of symptoms, because the incubation period is 2 weeks, or who had a contact, close contact with the confirmed case with this virus. This we have to discuss still. Close contact is defined, we thought of defining this as living in the same household or a patient who had direct contact with the body fluids of the patient. So we still we are in the process of discussing this. At the moment, there's a lot of panic caused by the definition given by the WHO, because the WHO says all this, and in addition these, they say in addition to this, if somebody had basically sort of any contact, like who had been within 2 meters of a patient, like, so then this has created a lot of confusion, and we get calls and we get admissions. Sometimes the reason for admission is somebody has dined in the same restaurant, or then somebody has served food to the confirmed patient, and that again is guess. So we had transfers coming from other hospitals, direct admissions, and this has been made worse by the social media. Yesterday we had a young girl. The reason for admission is she said, "I want to exclude corona." So I said, "What's the problem? I have got sore throat and fever. So why do you think you have corona? Have you been to China?" "No, I haven't been. But I watched the film in Scope Cinema Hall." And this WhatsApp message says on the same day, this positive case also watched the film there. So these are the problems we face because of this, the social panic created by social media. So in the hospital, what is recommended is at the entrance of the outpatient department, there should be a signage directing patients who had been to China within the past 14 days. And then immediately those patients should be asked to wear a surgical mask as soon as this suspicion is there. And then they should be evaluated by a medical officer in a well-ventilated room until the patient is transferred to an appropriate facility. And then we have to limit the caretakers, number of caretakers and visitors. And then healthcare workers should wear appropriate personal protective equipments and perform hand hygiene. So in the ward, what we recommend is to place the patient in an adequately ventilated single room. Now, ideally, this should be a negative pressure room, but we don't have negative pressure rooms. So therefore, we thought the best would be to keep the patient in an adequately ventilated single room. However, if single rooms are not available, then we will have to cohort these patients. So in such instances, we'll have to cohort them in, say, high-risk patients together, or maybe put high-risk patient in single rooms and put the low-risk patient in ward area. So one has to be selective in cohorting these patients. And even then, you have to keep these patients at least 1 meter apart, keep their beds at least 1 meter apart, so that the chances of getting this infection will be less. And when possible, of 2-3 days, and then they can change for the next 2-3 days. But if they are changing with every shift, every day, then it's going to be a problem, because then more and more people will be getting exposed. And also, when some people are doing it regularly, they get used to this wearing all this, which is not very easy. And then limiting and transporting movements of the patients. And even if the patient is transported, they instruct the patient to wear a surgical mask and to observe respiratory hygiene and cough etiquettes. These are the recommendations we put in our draft guideline. Of course, you have to get the ministry approval for that. The personal protective equipments are recommended for these categories. The N95 masks, IEO for facial protection, goggles or face shield, a clean, non-sterile, long-sleeved, fluid-resistant gown, apron if doing a procedure, and gloves. For these healthcare workers, triage nurse or the healthcare worker of first contact with the patient, healthcare workers who attend suspected or confirmed cases, healthcare workers who collect samples from the patient, waste collectors, healthcare workers who accompany the patient in the same compartment of the vehicle during transportation of the patient, and laboratory staff who perform tests. Of course, it can vary depending on the test and the testing environment. If they are doing in a BSL2 cabinet, then some of these precautions may not be necessary. Then we thought of recommending surgical masks for all patients to wear at all times, and it has to be changed at least 8 hours early, and then to caregivers and visitors, and not for the general public, of course. The problem, other problem, is the cleaning and disinfection of the area. The sodium hypochlorite 1% is quite effective, and we have to clean the bedside tables, bed frames, and the furniture with water and detergents. What we generally use is this. And then in addition, we have to clean medical devices, equipments, and other things also, or routine procedures. Equipments which cannot be washed or should be either disposed, or if you are reusing, we can use 70% alcohol to clean these equipments. Of course, drinking will not prevent the infection. So will we get it? Well, we didn't get SARS, but we got H1N1. Now, on both these occasions, we tried our best to prevent this infection from coming into the country. The Ministry of Health and many other organizations tried these things. I think the reason for not getting SARS is probably died down very quickly. On the other hand, the influenza came. Initially, we were isolating all these patients at IDH, but then after some time, it went into the community. And in the present context of this global transportation, it's very difficult to contain this sort of infections. However, we have only one patient at present, and the transmission in other countries are low, except in China. That is the other interesting thing. Even though there are cases reported, almost all of them are related to Wuhan, or if not, they have been a close contact or family member of a patient who had come back from Wuhan. We don't know, as mentioned earlier, there can be effect on the environment and the temperature. So hopefully, since we are in a more warmer climate, we might be protected. Who knows?
So that's very good.
Whatever it is, I think it is important to adhere to the basic principles of to reduce the general risk of transmission of respiratory infections. Now, this is a fundamental thing that will prevent us not only from corona, even from other infections, the influenza. And even with corona coming up, everybody seemed to have forgotten influenza, even the clinicians. Somebody with the slightest thing, say somebody working in a hotel or working in a place where Chinese people are working, come with these symptoms, they first suspect corona, not influenza, unfortunately. But we have influenza and still people die of influenza. That's the problem. And also adhering to these things will prevent or reduce, minimize the chances of getting all such infections. They avoid close contacts with people suffering from acute respiratory tract infection, frequent hand washing, especially after direct contact with ill people, avoiding unprotected contact with farm or wild animals. People with symptoms of acute respiratory infection should practice cough etiquettes. And then within healthcare facilities, enhance the standard infection prevention and control practices, especially in emergency departments. So finally, I would like to say mortality of this is much lower than SARS and MERS, much lower than projected by many media, especially the social media. However, transmission rate seems to be high, at least in China. And I don't think there's any necessity to panic. It is important to take general measures to protect from respiratory tract infections. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ananda Vijayakrama, for that very clear presentation and criteria related to the Sri Lankan situation and also highlighting the need for the simple and basic measures. The next presenter is about something that we are interested in, how the quarantine happens and what will happen once those suspected individuals come to the country. So Dr. Dilhani Samarasekara, who is representing the quarantine unit of the Ministry of Health, will be telling us about the preventive measures at the point of entry as well as within the country as well.
Thank you very much. Actually, most of the speakers, they have mentioned most of the things in my presentation also. Now, I'm from the quarantine unit. So quarantine unit deals with all airport and port health officers in the international points of entry in the country. So I just briefed Sri Lanka, there are national co-focal points for IHR, International Health Regulations. So quarantine unit and epidemiology unit are these IHR co-focal points. So if there's, that means the national center designated by each state party, which shall be accessible at all times for communication with WHO IHR contact points under these regulations. So IHR covers mainly 19 technical areas. This was happening for the past few years. So we are working with several other sectors, not only the airport aviation, animal sector, plant sector, every sector. So we have already been developed these contingency plans for the airports and ports. So what are the preventive measures taken in Sri Lanka at POEs? So BIA is a designated port, airport. Colombo port is a designated port. We have only two designated points of entry in Sri Lanka out of these international points of entry. So this designated BIA has, now we have developed the medical services mainly at BIA, not to, in other points of entry also there are medical services, but as BIA is the designated points of entry, and also during this case, most of the passengers are coming to the airport through BIA. So most of the measures are taken at BIA. So we conducted a meeting with ASL and other stakeholders at BIA to face this situation. So, and also another meeting has been conducted at Sri Lanka Ports Authority. So, as one of the previous speakers mentioned, announcement was given to all the flights arriving to Sri Lanka, regardless of the country. So, you must have seen two video clips. It takes only a few minutes to see. So, this video clip was in the airport since last week. So the passengers are informed about what to do, especially the Chinese passengers. They are, as previous speakers mentioned, they are taken from a separate terminal and they are given the health declaration form and referred to our health desk or the doctor if they have any symptoms. So these video clips we have given developed by us, the Ministry of Health, and displayed at the BIA. So that is for the people coming to BIA, asking them to go to the health office if they have a symptom. This video clip, after coming to Sri Lanka, if they develop any symptom, asking them to go to a hospital and mention their about their foreign travel. So we advise the health staff, because we have a group, Viber group. So all our points of entry staff, we advise through that also. In addition, we send emails to them on what to do. So health declaration form was developed and it was translated to Chinese also. And it includes, as mentioned earlier, passenger details, symptoms, from why they have come to Sri Lanka, because of work or any other reason. And what are the places they are going to stay in Sri Lanka, that sort of things are in this health declaration form, and data entered in an Excel sheet and it's sent to EPID unit, as mentioned earlier, because through the public health system in our country, they can be traced. So there are four thermal scanners in the BIA airport. One is at the airport health office, other three are placed at different places, and one at the specific terminal. So we conducted an awareness program at BIA. Actually, when we went there, almost all the people were wearing masks. Some were wearing N95 masks. We went without any masks. Even some people are inside the cubicle, actually we could do, but when we explained, most of the people, I didn't show the image with the mask, some people removed because some are not in contact with the passengers. So we explained them what to do and how to manage if contacting passengers. If the passengers are coughing, we advise them to give them a mask and ask them to sit at a place and refer to our health office for further management. And advisors for Sri Lankan students, nationals, and other foreign nationals returning from high-risk area of ongoing coronavirus has been developed by EPID unit. So we tell them about what to do when they return to Sri Lanka without symptoms, because as mentioned, only the people with temperature will be detected at the, through the thermal scanner, but in the health declaration form, they have to declare whether they have sore throat or any other illness. So this sort of thing, you can see from the epidemiology unit website also. And also we educate all the, because we screen all the passengers coming from flights, but specifically we get the passengers coming from Chinese airlines into a specific gate. Now, as mentioned earlier, the flight is planning to go to Wuhan. So actually with the assistance of other microbiologists, we developed some instructions for them how to do the cleaning, how to wear masks, that sort of things was disseminated to them. So communication to public is issued by the Ministry of Health. Two hotlines have been given, and media can get the details from the Health Promotion Bureau Facebook page, epidunit fact sheet, situation reports, disseminate. We from the quarantine unit, we used to disseminate the situation reports of WHO, because this has been done even before getting this coronavirus incidence, because from our quarantine unit, we are getting the reports from WHO if there's any condition in the world. So this time still WHO has not told that this is a public health emergency of international concern, but they send us the report, so we act accordingly. So these things were mentioned earlier. So through the WHO website, you can see these leaflets and other guidance. I'm not going to tell details. So the public should get correct messages from Health Promotion Bureau EPID websites. Using a mask incorrectly may actually increase the risk of transmission rather than reduce the risk, because some people ask which way to wear, blue side out, white side out, that sort of thing. So usually they have to wear the blue side out. So there are three layers, that sort of things were told to the staff at BIA who are handling with the patients or suspected people. So there are three layers. Those things are disseminated to people. So thank you very much. So if you have further questions, we can answer them during the question and answer session.
Thank you, Dr. Dilhani. There were a lot of mentions about WHO and its role. Now, Dr. Sapumal Dhanapala from WHO Country Office will be discussing with us about the role of WHO.
Good afternoon. I had a presentation ready, but I think this is not a time to have slides, because most of the presenters actually went through the WHO actions and what WHO has given as guidelines to all of you. So if there are questions, I can answer at the end of this few minutes. First of all, as WHO, the main mandate is make sure that you all are all safe in all countries. And that's why we have the international health regulations like Dilhani mentioned. So if the international health regulations are well established in countries, then there's no way that the diseases can be transmitted from one a country to another country. And it's a mandate of the country, if it's undergoing some outbreak or epidemic, to control or contain as much as possible within their borders, right? And that's why the IHR is there and inform all the global international health regulation partners through WHO and other international agencies. So as soon as this information came, I'm sure if you can go to the WHO website, you will see all these details. There are situation reports. The ninth one came out last night, which gives you the numbers. And it was mentioned by all the speakers before, so I will not go with the numbers, but few things that we need to understand, and we thank the government of Sri Lanka for doing it properly. One is making sure that the WHO given definition was taken up for laboratories and for clinical management. And on Sunday, I know all the clinicians sat down and developed a guideline, which was put out on the website on Monday itself. That's quite fast. The other area is the communication angle. Health Promotion Bureau has taken risk communication as a key area that WHO guidelines had been sent and has already started through their website countering rumors and also making sure that the correct message go out. we were a bit late. That's why this panic took place over the weekend. But we now need, as a country, to ensure that our unnecessary fear, like the conclusion said, should not create panic among ourselves first. Because when the doctors panic, and the rest of the community, today we had a meeting at the DMC, the Disaster Management Center, said the same thing. If the doctors are giving different information on different media, creating more contradicting each other, and that's what the media loves. So I'm sure you all would have learned more about this, and SLMA website thankfully has given the situation reports from WHO and the EPID unit, which gives very clear instruction and direction what we should do. Coming back to the disease, this is, if you look at the classification, China has been classified as very high risk, rest of the world risk, which means China has to do much more than the rest of the countries to ensure that the disease does not spread from China to other countries. So that's why they had this, with the Chinese New Year coming in, they had to lock down Wuhan city to make sure people do not go out of Wuhan, and of course they go to other countries. So that is something that the Chinese government did proactively. Second one is the numbers. If you look from the inception until now, there are about 5,600 odd cases. It might increase over the next period of time, but if you look at the population of Wuhan, it is the seventh most populated city in China. So it is if you look at the numbers and figures, you'll see that 5,600 compared to a population there, which is 11 million in Wuhan city, forget Hubei, you can understand the gravity of the infection which is there. And the numbers reported, like we said, the numbers of cases reported and the deaths are. I think we need to be more proactive to make sure that what we do at the borders, the epidemiology unit and the quarantine, the Minister of Health with Pawar leading the team and DG has put in place the best system possible to prevent the disease from coming into our shores, into our borders, which means that you need to have epidemiological science-based evidence in interventions at the point of entries, making sure people are screened when they have symptoms or returning from areas of suspect, especially from Hubei province, and with a contact to a patient. So if you look at the global 16 countries which have reported these conditions, not a single of those countries have reported from a patient to a health worker or any other transmission within. So which means if you look at global evidence, the chance of spread from an infected person is very minimal if you take all the precautions that we have recommended in the WHO guidelines. So as WHO, we will continue to support. Another main, I think we should thank Dr. Jude for establishing the testing facility within a very short time of 10 days, proactively discussing with Hong Kong so that we don't have to send samples out and wait for 2-3 days to get the reports. He can do the test, and which I'm sure the clinicians will be very happy that as soon as they suspect someone who falls within this definition of a corona suspect case, that they can get a test done within Sri Lanka and get the report so that you can manage the patient clearly. So the WHO will continue to support the country to make sure that this is curtailed, and we hope that the with the natural immunity increasing in China, that the numbers would come down as soon as possible. And like we said, like MERS and SARS, mortality is much lower than that, but and contagious wise, a bit high only in Wuhan city, but in the rest of the world where there are cases reported with contacts from China, like we was said earlier by the presenter, there is a minimum risk that it will come from if we have a very good border protection to protect this and screen these arrivals from the high risk areas, mainly in Hubei, China. So I think if there are any questions later on, we can answer, but I think that's the key message.
Thank you, Dr. Sapmar, for highlighting the need for strengthening the system. Now we have our final presenter. It's about the migration, because there are a lot of concerns about the migration workers, migrant workers in Sri Lanka. The next presenter is Dr. Indrakanta Velgama from the International Organization for Migration.
afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm here representing the International Organization for Migration. Now, basically, we are going to, what we deal is with migration. And we will be talking, we don't have a specific role as such, but in general, everything about migration is our role. So that is why we are going to talk about this, because now the 2019 coronavirus outbreak has a lot to do with migration. So if you look at what the definition of migration is, it is the movement of a person or people away from their usual place of residence. Okay, it can be either internally within a country or it can be internationally as well. So the reasons for migration, if you look, are numerous. People migrate a lot for employment, education, economic benefits, and for residence as well. So if we look at the current global migration trends, we can see that according to the IOM global statistics, nearly 1 billion people move throughout the world, and 30% of them are only moving out of their country, from one country to another country, whereas 70% or more are usually moving within their country. So if we look at the current novel coronavirus outbreak, it started from Wuhan in the Hubei province in China. So if you look at where Wuhan is, it's like the commercial hub of central China. It's situated somewhere in the middle of China. And it is where the main commercial activities of central China is happening. So there are lots of people who are working there. There are industrial zones, there are educational institutions, there are commercial interchanges. So lots of outsiders from China, other areas of China, are working inside in this Wuhan region. And also it's a transportation hub. That means like people from one region come there for exchange of goods, and then they take to another. So a lot of people move around in and around this Hubei province. So that is one of the reasons why this the disease, which was supposed to have started in the Wuhan city, rapidly spread to all parts of China. The main reason is the internal migration. And the other thing was, like, this is, if you look back, look at the Chinese New Year, this is the time of the period where they have the holidays. So people in working, especially the labor population, the students who have been in and around Wuhan would have gone back to their hometowns in other parts of China, taking the disease with them. So that is why it has rapidly spread throughout the country. And then now we see that it is spreading out of China as well. Again, the reason is we have lots of Chinese people working outside in other countries, including Sri Lanka. People who are from the Wuhan region, who have gone home for their new year, are returning. And this is one of the reasons why this epidemic is now crossing the borders as well. So what is IOM and what is IOM's role? So IOM is actually the leading intergovernmental agency. It's a United Nations related agency, which works with all governments, non-governmental organizations in relation to migration. The main aim is to promote what is called safe, orderly, and regular migration for the benefit of all. That means benefit of the migrants, as well as the sending countries, as well as the receiving countries. So that is the main aim of IOM. And IOM itself, in this context of migration, has a migration health division, apart from various other divisions in relation to migration. So in Sri Lanka also, IOM was established in 2002, and we have a migration health division, which works in close collaboration with the health ministry. So with regard to the migration health division of IOM, there are three main pillars of migration health that we advocate for. One is the health assessments and travel assistance. That is, people traveling from one area to another area, they need to undergo health assessment. They need to be healthy. That is for the benefit of the migrants as well as for the receiving countries. The second one is migration health governance and health promotion. The receiving countries need to understand the importance of health among these people who are coming into their country. Third one is health emergency response. So like in health emergencies, such as in Ebola or in disaster situations, we can see lots of people either migrating out or out of their country, out of the disaster area, and there's a lot of displacement, and in which case, lots of health-related assistance is needed, and IOM is there to assist them. So with relation to migrant-sensitive healthcare services, now this is something which is important because this deals with, like if we take migrants, if we are like even within a country, people from different areas will come go into different areas. That means they will have different cultural aspects, they will have different languages. And this is, now if we take this current epidemic where the Chinese are concerned, one of the main drawbacks or one of the main challenges that Sri Lanka is facing is the language barrier. Now, if we take the Chinese, most of the Chinese are actually in the labor population. And there are lots of Chinese probably from the Hubei province who are coming in. And they, apart from Chinese, have very little understanding of other languages. So whatever information we try to get from them, whatever information we try to give them, they will not be understanding. So it is very important that we address these migrants in a migrant-sensitive manner. So there are three C's what we talk about in migrant-sensitive healthcare services. One is communication, as I told you. That is the language and the cultural sensitivities of the migrants that we are addressing. If we address them in the wrong way, they will not understand us. Second one is the continuity of care. So that is like we should have some way. Now, if we identify, for example, a person with a disease, that person, after identification, what are we going to do? We should have some plan for that. And third one is confidence. That is, we have to impart the confidence on the migrant also that if you are detected here, you will have some action taken on it. That means, like, if somebody has a disease and comes here, for example, a person, a Chinese person with symptoms of novel coronavirus, now he will be knowing that he is having a dangerous disease. That is his perception. So once he comes in and we ask him about the symptoms, he might try to hide them because he will not have the confidence to tell us because he won't know what the repercussions would be. So that is, again, something we should need to think about. And finally, the IOM Migration Health Division is currently conducting health assessments. We have two health assessments, the outbound, which is conducted for Sri Lankans going abroad, and the inbound health assessment, which we conduct on behalf of the health ministry for resident visa applicants coming into Sri Lanka. For outbound, majority are Sri Lankans, so we just do a scanning. We ask them the symptoms, and if there is any positivity, we inform the quarantine unit, but otherwise we do not, we go ahead with the procedures. But for inbound health assessment, the inbound health assessment is for non-Sri Lankans, foreigners coming into Sri Lanka requesting resident visa. So they have to undergo this program, this health assessment within 1 month, technically, after they arrive in the country. So here what we do is we work in close coordination with the quarantine unit and the Department of Immigration. And currently for this coronavirus epidemic, we have set up several specific procedures, that is, all applicants coming from China, we have delayed them, the health assessments for them to be done only after 14 days of arrival in the country. And then other thing is, even other for nationals, not the Chinese, but Chinese plus or any other foreigners coming in, we give them, we do what is called a surveillance. We give them a questionnaire, find out whether they have been to China or any other region which has had this disease, and also we have find out whether they have any symptoms. And if so, if there are any positive cases, we inform the quarantine unit. Also, we do what is called the temperature recording of such applicants just to ensure that they do not have fever or any symptoms. And apart from that, within the facilities, we have the basic hygienic measures such as hand sanitation and the face mask freely available for those who would like, and we promote wherever there is a risk situation. So these are the things that we do, but it's like it's the general day-to-day practices that we do, but a little beyond the normal practice for the novel coronavirus. But what is more important is that thinking of this and thinking of migration as a global issue, this is not the first and the last time this sort of thing will happen. It will happen in the future as well. So I think it is important that we take necessary precautions and measures as a health unit, as a health ministry, as a country, to have this sort of program in place so that these sort of epidemics can easily be encountered and managed at the onset itself. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Indrakanta. Now we come to the moment that most of us have been looking forward to, because you may be having a lot of areas for concern and clarifications. Now I would like to invite all the resource persons to the podium, to the stage, so that we can have a discussion with the audience related to the issues and the concerns that you have. Can I invite Dr. Sudhat Samaravira, Dr. Ananda, Dr. Dilhani, and Dr. Sapumal, and Dr. Indrakanta to the stage? And you can ask questions in whatever language. Janamadhya Sandha, Singhala ho English Bhashayen Prashna Ahanna Puluwang. Obata Singhala Bhashayen Prashna Ahanna Awashya Nam. E wagema Demala Bhashayen Api Visheshayama Sakas Karala Tiyenawa Torotoru Patrikawak. We have special leaflet in Tamil as well. So all of you are free to ask any questions or concerns from any of our audience. And please identify yourself and keep your question very briefly.
SARS was the virus yield. The virus was mostly identified of the blood or other things. The stools had the highest yield. So there are nothing mentioned anything about the corona and the stools. Is there any connection or can you give anything on that?
Sir, there's a light request. Can you move to the microphone? Because the
microphone. Yeah, I think I can answer that question. The thing is, the question was whether the stools and other secretions, whether can they be infected with? Yeah. The thing is, this is a novel coronavirus, but the available data is limited. But we can extrapolate from the previous two, the MERS and the SARS. So even in SARS, you know, even if you are recovered, sometimes you can keep excreting. That's a known thing. The knowledge on this is limited, but definitely viremia has been recorded. They have found viremia, virus in blood. So possibly they are excreting that as well. So, I mean, this is a very virus which is related to SARS, very close to SARS. So the behavior we can anticipate the more or less similar behavior. Possibility, but I mean, but anyway, respiratory features are predominant. So the infection acquired and transmitted through the mainly through the respiratory. So I mean, if we can identify a patient, then we can implement the necessary measures. And generally, even in SARS, I think what they do is they discharge a patient once the virus is negative in the respiratory secretions. So
that is the general practice.
But regarding stools, I don't think that should be a concern at the moment.
තියෙන ප්‍රධානම ප්‍රශ්නය තමයි මේ වෛර මේ රෝගේ රටට ඇතුල් වීම. ඒක පාලනය කිරීම සඳහා කරන කරන කටයුතු ටික පැහැදිලි වුණා මේ සාකච්ඡාවේදී. මෙතෙන්දී වැදගත්ම දේ තමයි එතකොට ඒ යම් කිසි විදිහකින් මේ රෝගේ වැළඳිච්ච කෙනෙක් ලංකාවට පැමිණීම සහ ලංකාවේදී රෝගේ නැතත් රෝගේ වෛරසය සමග ලංකාවට ඇවිල්ලා ඒ මුල් සති දෙක තුලදී ඔවුන් හඳුනා ගැනීම, ඒ සඳහා ඒ යාන්ත්‍රණය ක්‍රියාත්මක වෙච්ච නිසා තමයි අපි අඳුනාගත්තු පළවෙනි චීන ජාතික කාන්තාව ඒ දැනුවත් වීම තිබුණ නිසා තමයි පළවෙනි චීන ජාතික කාන්තාව ඒ රෝගයේ රෝග ලක්ෂණ ආපු පළවෙනි දවසේම ඇතුළුනේ. අපි හිතන්නේ ඒක එක්තරා විදිහට සාර්ථක දෙයක්. ඊළඟ දේ තමයි අපි ඒ යාන්ත්‍රණය ක්‍රියාත්මක කරලා තියෙනවා, අපි දැනුවත් කරලා තියෙනවා, ජනතාව දැනුවත් කිරීම කරනවා, මේ විශේෂයෙන්ම චීනයේ සිටලා හෝ නැත්නම් මේ ප්‍රදේශවල සිට ලංකාවට පැමිණෙන අය. ඒ වගේම අපේ තියෙන ප්‍රාදේශීයව තියෙන සෞඛ්‍ය වෛද්‍ය නිලධාරීන්, ඒ වගේම ප්‍රාදේශීය අසංගත රෝග විද්‍යාඥයන් ඒගොල්ලන්ව දැනුවත් කරලා තියෙනවා. ඒගොල්ලෝ ප්‍රාදේශීය මොකද කරන්න ඕනේ කියලා අදත් ප්‍රාදේශීය අසංගත රෝග විද්‍යාඥයන් ලංකාවට කොළඹට පැමිණලා තියෙනවා. දැන්ට සාකච්ඡාව යනවා මොකද්ද ඒගොල්ලෝ විසින් ගතියුතු කියලා. එතකොට ඒ විදිහට මේ වගේ රෝගීන් හිටියොත් ඒගොල්ලන්ව වහාම අඳුනා ගැනීම සහ ඔන්න ඩෙසිග්නේටඩ් එහෙම නැත්නම් අඳුනාගත්ත රෝහලකට ඇතුල් කරලා එතනින් පරීක්ෂණ පැවැත්වීම අපි විසින් සිද්ධ කරනවා. එතකොට එහෙම කරලා අපිට පුළුවන් වෙනවා මේ රෝගය පාලනය කරන්න. මේ මොහොත වෙනකොට අපි රෝගයක් අඳුනගෙන තියෙනවා. ඊට අමතරව මේ වෛරසය ලංකාවේ පරිසරයේ පැතිරෙනවා කියන සංසකරණය වෙනවා කියන කිසිම සාධකයක් නැහැ. සමහර රෝහල් කීපයකට රෝගීන් පැමිණලා තියෙනවා. කිසිම රෝගියෙක් අනතුරුදායක තත්ත්වයක නැහැ. සියලුම රෝගීන් සාමාන්‍ය රෝග තත්ත්වයෙන් ඉන්නේ. ගොඩක් අය රිකවර් වෙනවා. සමහර අඳුරගත මේ සැක් කරපු අය දැන්ටමත් ඩිස්චාර්ජ් වෙලා ගිහිල්ලා තියෙනවා. දැනට බට උදේ ලැබුණු සංඛ්‍යා ලේඛන දැනට 16ක් පමණ ජාතික නකෝහලේ ඇතුළේ ඉන්නවා.
ඒක සම්පූර්ණ බොරුවක්. මට ඉතාම කනගාටුයි ඒ වගේ දෙයක් ජාතික පුවත්පතක පළ කිරීම ගැන අපේ රෝහලෙන් විමසීමක් නොකර. දෙවන කාරණය, අද උදේ රූපවාහිනියේ මේ පුවත් කියවනකොට මේක බොහොම සෞඛ්‍ය සේවකයන් බොහොම නිර්දය ලෙස විවේචනය කරලා තියෙනු මේ පුවත පදනම් කරගෙන. ඉතින් ඒ අයටත් අපි දකිනවා මේ පුවත් කියවනකොට බොහෝ විට මේ දේශපාලනඥයන්ගන් ෆෝන් එකෙන් සම්බන්ධ කරගන්නවා. ඉතින් මන් දන්නේ ඇයි රෝහල් අධ්‍යක්ෂකතුමා හෝ වෙන කෙනෙක් ඒ අවස්ථාවේ සම්බන්ධ කරගත්තේ නැත්තේ මොකද කියලා. මොකද මේ අවස්ථාවේ අපි දන්නවා නිතරම මේ මාධ්‍යවේදීන් අපිට කතා කරනවා. ඉතින් අපි ඉතාමත්ම කනගාටු වෙනවා ඒ වගේ දෙයක් නිසි සොයා බැලීමකින් තොරව පුවත්පතේ පළ කිරීමත්, ඒ වගේම ඒ පුවත ඊට පස්සේ අද උදේ රූපවාහිනී නාලිකාවලින් සමහර නාලිකාවලින් බොහොම නිර්දය ලෙස විවේචනය කරමින් කතා කිරීම සම්බන්ධිනුත් මේ ගැන මම විශේෂයෙන්ම හොයලා බැලුවා මේක පළ වුණ නිසා. ඊයේ දවස් ඇතුළත සුළු සේවකයින් 87 ඊයේ උදේවරුවේ සුළු සේවකයින් 87 දෙනෙක් වැඩ කරලා තියෙනවා. ඊයේ උදේවරුවේ ඊයේ රෑ 33 දෙනෙක් වැඩ කරලා තියෙනවා. ඒක තමයි සාමාන්‍ය ගාන. අද උදේ 87 දෙනෙක් වැඩ කරනවා. ඒක තමයි සාමාන්‍ය රෝහලේ මේ සේවක මණ්ඩලයේ වැඩ කරන සංඛ්‍යාව. එයාගේ කිසිම ගැටලුවක් නැතුව වැඩ කරනවා. ඒ වගේම අවශ්‍ය මේ රෝගීන්ට ප්‍රවේශ රෝගීන්ගෙන් ප්‍රවේශම් වීම සැක කටයුතු රෝගීන්ගෙන් ප්‍රවේශම් වීම සඳහා අවශ්‍ය උපාංග සෞඛ්‍ය මාත්‍ය මගින් සපයලා තියෙනවා. ඒ කියන්නේ කිසිම අඩුපාඩුවක් නැහැ. ඒ නිසා මට පැහැදිලිවම කියන්න පුළුවන් මේ සම්පූර්ණ මේ පළවෙච්ච කතාව සම්පූර්ණ බොරුවක්. ඇත්තටම මේකෙන් වෙන්නේ ඒ වගේ ප්‍රවෘත්ති දැම්මහම වෙන්නේ අනිත් හොස්පිටල්ස් වලයිත් බය වෙනවා. අනිත් රෝහල් වල ඉන්න සේවක සේවකයන්වත් බය වෙනවා. ඉතින් ඒ නිසා මේ වගේ වැරදි මත දැන් දැනටම ජනතාව බය කරලා තියෙන්නේ. මේකට සම්පූර්ණයෙන්ම වගේ කියන්න ඕන මේ සෝෂල් මීඩියා සහ අපේ ට්‍රැඩිෂනල් මීඩියා. අපි දන්නවා දැන් අපි දැක්ක පහුගිය දවස්වල මම හිතන්නේ මේ කියන්න ඕනේ මේ වෙලාවේ සමහර රූපවාහිනී ප්‍රවෘත්තිවල පෙන්නවා මේ චීන ජාතිකයෝ පාරේ ඇවිදගෙන යන ගමන් එකපාරට චීන ජාතිකයෙක් වැටෙනවා. ඉතින් එහෙම වෙන්නේ නැහැ මේ කොරෝනා වෛරසය. කොරෝනා වෛරසය කියන්නේ ශ්වසන පද්ධතියට හැදෙන රෝගයක්. ඉතින් ඒකෙදි ඒකෙදි වෙන්නේ මේ නියුමෝනියා හැදිලා අමාරු වෙන එකත් වෙන්නේ නියුමෝනියා හැදිලා කැස්ස වැඩි වෙලා හුස්ම ගන්න අමාරු වෙලා තමයි මේ රෝගීන්ට අසාධ්‍ය තත්ත්වයන් එන්නේ. එහෙම නැතු මේ ඇවිදගෙන මිනිස්සු දරස් ගාලා වැටෙන්නේ නැහැ. ඉතින් මේව පෙන්වුවාම ඊට පස්සේ මිනිස්සු බය වෙනවා. ඉතින් අපි දැක්කා පෙරේදා මේ බය වීම නිසා සිද්ධ වෙච්ච දෙයක්. මම හිතන්නේ ස්ටොක් එක්ස්චේන්ජ් එකේ කවුරු හරි වැටෙනවා, කවුරුවත් ළඟට යන්නේ නැහැ මේ SARS කියලා කොරෝනා කියලා බය වෙලා. ඒ தත්ත්වය ඇති කිරීම ගැන අපි ඉතාත්මත්ම කනගාටු වෙනවා. ඒ නිසා අපි වගකීමෙන් ඉල්ලා සිටිනවා මාධ්‍ය වලින් මේ අවස්ථාවේ වගකීම යුතු විදිහට වැඩ කරන්න. මේක මේ බය විය යුතු தත්ත්වයක් නැහැ. ලංකාවේ එක රෝගියෙක් හොයාගෙන තියෙන ඒ රෝගියා වුහාන් වලින්ද ලාපු කෙනෙක්. ලංකාව තුල මේක පැතිරෙන බවට කිසිම දැනට සාධකයක් නැහැ. එහෙම එනවද කියලා බලන්න අපි හැම උත්සාහයක්ම ගන්නවා. එහෙම ආවොත් ඒ සඳහා නිසි පියවර ගන්න සෞඛ්‍ය අමාත්‍යාංශ සම්පූර්ණ අවශ්‍ය ක්‍රියාමාර්ග අරගෙන තියෙනවා. ඒ නිසා කරුණාකර ඒ පණිවිඩය ජනතාවට දෙන්න. මේ ගැන රෝහල් සේවකයෝ බොහොම කැපවීමෙන් වැඩ කරන්නේ. ඒක පැහැදිලිව කියන්න ඕන. ඉතින් අපිට හරි කනගාටුයි ඒ වගේ වැඩ කරද්දී රෝහල් සේවකයෝ, වෛද්‍යවරු, හෙදියන්, අනිකුත් සේවක සේවිකාවන් ඉතාමත්ම කැපවීමෙන් වැඩ කරන්නේ. එහෙම තත්ත්වයකදී මේ වගේ වැරදි පුවත් පළවීම ගැන අපිට ඉතාමත්ම කනගාටුයි. I don't know about the ship. Sorry, I haven't heard. I don't know whether Sudhat has anything. The ship, there was a ship from China, Sri Lankan sailor, I'm sorry that we don't have such information. Regarding the hotel employee, again, this is the panic created by this contacts. Then a hotel e weda karana kaanthawa ee man pariksha karanakota ya kiwwe me mama me hotel eke weda karanawa den mama giyahama magen eho kohida weda karanne me hotel e kiwwa gaman eya kelimma idh ekata ewwa mehema sakayak tiyenawa kiyala ethe ya kiwwe ita passe ya kiyenawa man e unata weda karanne kussiye mama chef me mama me minissut ekka sambandhayak wenna ඉතින් ඒක තමයි ඇත්ත. ඒ කාන්තාව අපි ඩිස්චාර්ජ් කළා යව්වා. ඉතින් ඒකේ ප්‍රශ්නේ වුණේ ඒ කාන්තාව ගේන එක වීඩියෝ කළා නිවුස් වල දැම්මා. දැන් අපි මෙතනදී දිගටම ප්‍රකාශ වුණා වගේ මේ වෛරසය අලුත හොයාගත් එකක්. ඒ නිසා අපි මේ ගැන දන්න තොරතුරු 100%ක්ම දන්නේ නැහැ. හැබැයි පොදුවේ ගත්තාම මේ කොරෝනා වෛරසය මේ තාපයෙන් බොහොම ඉක්මනට විනාශ වෙනවා. මම කියතයි නේ. ඔව් ටෙම්පරේචර් එක බොහොම ඉක්මනට විනාශ වෙනවා. ඒ නිසා මේ උයන මේ සෝරි උයන කෑම වල ඒක තියෙන විදියක් නැහැ. ඔව් මෙහෙමයි. දැන් දැනට මම දන්නේ ඊයේ එක මාධ්‍යයකින් හොඳ වැඩක් කරා. හොඳ දේත් අගය කරන්න ඕනේ. එක මාධ්‍යයකින් හොඳ වැඩක් කරා. මම දැක්කා මේ මහාචාර්ය මලික් පීරිස් ස්කයිප් හරහා සම්බන්ධ කරගෙන කතා කරනවා. ඒ එතුමගෙන් අහපු එක ප්‍රශ්නයක් තමයි මේ සර්ජිකල් මාස්ක් පාවිච්චි කරන්නේ. ඉතින් එතුම පැහැදිලිව කිව්වා ලංකාවේ මේක නැහැ නේ දැනට. ඉතින් මොකටද මේ පාවිච්චි කරන්නේ කියලා. ඉතින් ඒක තමයි එතුම දීපු උත්තරේ. දැන් චීනේ වගේ තත්ත්වයක් ආවොත් එදාට අපි පාවිච්චි කරනවද කියන එක එදාට කල්පනා කරලා බලන්න ඕනේ. ඉතින් දැනට එහෙම එකක් නැහැ. good thanks namo danata vela tiyenne dan me mask iwarala tiyenne eka ine me bhitikawak athi galla ithin virus e nathi welawak api me okkoma pawichchi karanna aran antime awashya wena kale awashya unoth hadissi api prarthana karana awashya nowewa kiyala awashya unoth edata ewa nathi wenawa eka wenne ithin danata e nisa mask awashya naha api sandahan kara ara samanya swasana aasadana walin walakinna gathayutu kriyaamarga ewa thamai gannona ithi api karunawen illa sitinawa maadhya wala janata me sambandhen danuwat karanna. එතකොට ඒ දේවල් වලින් පුළුවන් අපිට මේ ශසන ආසාදනයන් වලින් වැළකෙන්න කොරෝනා ආසාදනය ඇතුළුව. ඊයේ වෙනකොට ඇවිල්ලා තියුණා 23 දෙනෙක්. ඊට පස්සේ රෑ තව මං හිතන්නේ 8 දෙනෙක් විතර ඇතුළු වෙලා තිබුණා. ඒ මේ දක්වා ඇතුළු සියලුම අය. හැබැයි ඒ අයගෙන් සැකසිත කියලා ආවට සමහර අය අපි කතා කරලා බැලුවම කිසිම සැකයක් නැහැ. ඒ අයගේ පරීක්ෂණ කරෙත් නැහැ. ඒ අයට වෙන වෙනම තිබුණ රෝග තත්ත්ව වලට බෙහෙත් දීලා ඒගොල්ලෝ ගෙදර යවුවා. නෑ දැනට 16ක් නෑ. දැන් ඒ එතුමා කිව්වේ අද උදේ හිටිය තත්ත්වේ. ඊට පස්සේ දැන් අපි උදේ වෝඩ් රවුන් කරාට පස්සේ තත්ත්වේ වෙනස් වුණා. දැන් ඒ 16න් ඒ 16න් 8 දෙනෙක් විතර දැන් ගෙදර ගිහිල්ලා තව කීප දෙනෙක් ඉන්නවා වෙන දේවල් නිසා. ඒ එක්කෙනෙකුගේ අපිට සැකයක් තියෙනවා එයාට තියෙන ඩෙන්ගු කියලා. තව එක්කෙනුට අපිට සැකයක් තියෙනවා එයාට තියෙන මේ උගුරු ආසාදනයක් කියලා. එයාගේ වාර්තා එනකන් ඒගොල්ලෝ තාම ඉන්නවා. ඒ අපි සැක කරන අය 3 දෙනෙක්ගේ සඳහා අපි සාම්පල් යවල තියෙනවා. ඒ අය ප්‍රතිඵල එනකන් රඳවගෙන ඉන්නවා. දියතලාවට මේ දක්වා කවුරුත් එක ගිහිලා නැහැ. නෑ දැනට මම දන්න මමත් ඒක ගැන දන්නේ නැහැ. මම දැන් ඩොක්ස් දත්ත ඒක ගැන කියන්න පුළුවන්
කියලා. ඔකේ වාතාංශය තිය. සෞඛ්‍ය අමාත්‍යාංශය තීරණයක් ගත්තා. ඒක වුහාන් වල රැඳවලා ඉන්න ශිෂ්‍යනු ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ පවුල් වලක අය ඉන්නවා 30-35 අතර ප්‍රමාණයක්. ඒගොල්ලෝ ලංකාවට ආපුවම දියතලාවට ගෙනියනවායි කියලා. තාම ඒගොල්ලෝ ලංකාවට ඇවිල්ලා නැහැ. තාම වුහාන් ප්‍රදේශයට ඇක්සස් එකවත් නැහැ. යන්නවත් බෑ කිසිම කෙනෙකුට. ඉතින් ඒක නිසා ඒගොල්ලෝ අනාගතයේදී ඉදිරියේ දවසක ආපුවම තමයි එතෙන්ට යන්නේ. එහෙම නැතුව අනිත් ප්‍රදේශවල ගැන කිසිම ශිෂ්‍යෙක් අපි රඳවගන්නේ නැහැ. මේ අවශ්‍යතාවයකුත් නැහැ. එහෙම yeah, that's at the early stage the one student was admitted. I don't know the exact situation now. The first patient, I think, can you sorry, sorry? Yes. Yes, the with the available evidence, with the available evidence, there is no any harm that that importing any good.
Because there are many Chinese who are living amongst us. Now, we don't know whether they went to Wuhan or where they went. Can you give us some general guidelines for the other Sri Lankans and people who are living in those apartments amongst Chinese? Chinese who have returned from China.
මං සිංහලෙන් උත්තරය දෙන්නම්. මේක විශේෂයෙන් මං විශ්වාස කරනවා මේක ජනතාවට දැන එක වැදගත් කියලා. මං කලින් සඳහන් කරා අපිට දැනට මේ කොරෝනා වෛරසය, නව කොරෝනා වෛරසය ආසාදිත එක රෝගියෙක් ඉන්නව චීනෙන් ආපු. එහෙම නැතුව අපි දන්නේ නැහැ මේ වෛරසය දැනට ලංකාව තුළ පැතිරෙන බවට කිසිම සාධකයක් නැහැ. හැබැයි ඉන්ෆ්ලුවෙන්සා වෛරසය තියෙනවා. ඉන්ෆ්ලුවෙන්සා වෛරසය වැඩි වැරඳුණු රෝගීනුත් ඉන්නවා. ඉන්ෆ්ලුවෙන්සා වෛරසයෙන් දැනටත් රෝගීන් මිය යනවා. ඉතින් නමුත් මේ කොරෝනා එක නිසා අපි ඉන්ෆ්ලුවෙන්සා මතක් කරලා තියෙන්නේ. අපි කිව්වම ඩොක්ටර්ස්ලාත් ඇතුළුව. ඉතින් ඒක තමයි මේ ඇති වෙලා තියෙන පැනික් එකේ ප්‍රතිඵලය. ඉතින් ඒ නිසා මෙතනදී අවශ්‍ය වෙන්නේ දැන් මේ කොරෝනා වෛරසයත් සට වැළඳෙන වෛරසයක්. ඉතින් ඒ නිසා අපි මේ සඳහා ගත යුතු මේ මේන් වැළකීම සඳහා ගත යුතු ක්‍රියාමාර්ග ඔක්කොම එක වගේ තියෙනවා. ඉතින් එතනදී අපි කියන්නේ නිරෝගී කෙනෙක් නම් අනවශ්‍යව සෙනග අධිකව ගැවසෙන තැන් වලට යන්න එපා. ඒ තැන් වලදී ඒ විෂ බීජ වැතිවීමේ ඉඩකඩ වැඩි. දෙවනුව නිරෝගී කෙනෙක් නම් මේ විෂ බීජ අපිට ඇතුල් වෙන්නේ එක්කෝ වෙන කෙනෙක් රෝගී කෙනෙකුගේ කෙනෙක් කහිනකොට නැත්තම් කිවිසිනකොට අපි මීටරයක් එකහමාරක් අතර ළඟක හිටියොත්. එහෙම නැත්තම් මේ විෂ බීජ තියෙන පෘෂ්ඨයක් අතගාලා අපි නාහයකට ඇල්ලුවොත්. ඒ නිසා ඔබේ අත් දෙක පිරිසිදු තියාගන්න. සෙනග ගැවසෙන තැන නොයා ඉන්න. ඔබට රෝග ලක්ෂණ තියෙනම් මොනව හරි කැස්ස හිඹිරිස්සාව වුණ ඔබෙන් ඒ අනිත් අයට යන එක වළක්වන්න ආරක්ෂා පියවර ගන්න. අන්න ඒ අයට තමයි මාස්ක් එක ඕනේ. සර්ජිකල් මාස්ක් එක ඕන වෙන්නේ ඔබට රෝගක ලක්ෂණ තියෙනම් ඒගොල්ලෝ මාස්ක් එක දාන්නේ හොඳයි. ඒතර අනිත් ඇට වැළඳෙන එක අඩු වෙනවා. මේ මො හරිනේ.
From a clinician's point of view, as you mentioned, two antivirals. If there's an outbreak, what contingencies are there in Sri Lanka, and whether is there a place of oseltamivir which you use for influenza in this city? Is there any evidence for it?
No, from the available evidence, there's nothing to say oseltamivir is useful. The other antivirals, they are studying. Still, we don't have any proven benefit of those. So at the moment, අපිට ඖෂධයක් කියලා දෙයක් දන්නේ නැහැ. ඉතින් මේ සියලුම වෛරස් බොහෝ වෛරස් ආසාදන ස්වාභාවිකම හොඳ වෙනවා ශරීරයේ ප්‍රතිශක්තියෙන්. ඉතින් එතකන් ප්‍රතිශක්තිය ප්‍රශ්න આવොත් තමයි ගැටලුව තියෙන්නේ. වෙනත් රෝගීන් ගෙදර යාමට වඩා වෙලා තියෙන්නේ රෝගීන් ඇතුල් වෙන එක අඩු වෙලා තියෙනවා. ඉතින් ඒකට ඉතින් ඒක දැන් පත්තරේ දැම්මම වැඩ කරන මිනිස්සුත් නිවාඩු යනවායි කියලා ඉතින් රෝගීන් බය වෙන එක අහන්න දෙයක් නෑ නේද? ඉතින් ඒක පව් ඉතින් මේ මිනිස්සුන්ට ඒ தත්ත්වයට පත් කරනවා පත් කළා තියෙනවා ඉතින් මේ වැරදි ප්‍රචාර නිසා.
We have some many participants who are online with us at about 100 participants and there are some questions from them also. Dr. Pramod, can you very briefly tell what are the questions? Yeah, please, the microphone. Dr. Pramod, so there are about many online questions that are coming up. Just to sum up, briefly, if you can tell what are the concerns? Very briefly.
Online, I'll let you know, I'll ask you a question.
So right now we have about 15 questions. So I will just briefly take a few of them. The first question from Ushani Rajapaksha. Do you know the sensitivity and specificity of the diagnostic PCR test that is currently available?
I would like to answer the question. The first thing is, this is experimental assay. We don't have any, but it's validated enough. So this PCR test, these tests are multi-steps assays. So there are several assays actually. So the first assay is you generally use for screening. It's a very high, it has very high sensitivity for that particular group. Then once screening is positive, then there are confirmatory assays. Generally, since this is experimental one, they have that kind of a multi-step approach. Then in the confirmatory assay, they specifically look for that specific region of the virus. So if the screening is positive, it means it's either a coronavirus or a beta coronavirus, probably. And when they in the second assay, they look for the specific region of this because they have published, as I mentioned, they have published the entire genome of these the first few viruses. That is enough to get develop a consensus genome, and from that there are specific regions which are not seen in other viruses. So they look for the specific region, then you can detect that as well. So that is highly sensitive and specific.
The next question from Dr. Achala Balasuri: is diagnostic testing available in the private sector?
I'm not the person to answer that. But I gather that, I don't think so. But other thing is, at this moment, I cannot comment, but since sometimes, sometimes we consider this a high consequence pathogen. So that case, it would be better if you can direct a patient to the government channels, rather than going for the private sector at the moment.
In the private sector, no test is available.
From Dr. Dinesh Fernando, how should the deaths be managed in case of an autopsy is required? What is the danger to the pathologist and the staff?
I suppose we don't have GMOs in this audience. Yeah,
but there are recommended methods of handling an autopsy in this sort of situations. It's not limited to, we don't have any experience with, of course, with this. But these recommendations are based on SARS and MERS, which are much more infective and also had a much more mortality rate. So I believe if we apply those practices and guidelines, I think one can do a safe autopsy.
The next question, if the virus can survive in low temperature and humid environment, is it safe to quarantine suspected people in an area like Diyathalava?
Actually, plans are going on to separate them, to have them in separate rooms. So out of the students, 33 students staying in Wuhan, one is staying with the mother. So actually only 32 rooms are needed. The army has done the structure so far, then wait until they come, right?
Yeah. The next question, what would be the donor criteria for blood donors regarding possible coronavirus infection?
I don't think anybody can answer that question in the world probably. We don't have any data.
The next question from Rajita. How do you define a case? Do you admit all the people arriving from China or people who have traveled Hubei province, China?
At the moment what we practice is, the WHO criteria says to suspect, for the suspected case, the definition is if a patient is coming from Wuhan with respiratory symptoms or somebody had direct contact with the patient. However, to be on the safe side, we have slightly changed that. We consider any patient with respiratory symptom coming from China, not only from Wuhan, coming from China. This is to save, better safety for our people. As a suspected case.
All right. The next question.
But they have to have respiratory symptoms or a direct contact with the patient.
Right. The next question from Dr. Ishara Vijayasinghe. What are the factors that would determine high mortality in an individual?
As all of us showed that we have only one study giving details of these cases. So according to that, the old age is the possible understood the reason. And the comorbidities, yes. Yeah. But that is only a small series of this.
I think other questions maybe we can ask from a resource person and then post them online because we have our online platforms. So any more questions from the audience? If there are, yes, yeah, please.
Do you have any data regarding how long the virus expression is there? Because regarding this patient, when we hope to discharge, now even without clinical symptoms, is there any data to say that how long the virus excretion is?
Actually, madam, the available data is limited, so very limited. So anyway, it's too early to discuss about any the dynamics of the virus. But so it depends. So what I mean, looked at CDC criteria. So what they say is that it should be individually assessed. The patient should be individually assessed. So the WHO criteria, it says, I mean, what is given is they say that if the patient has recovered, then you can wait 24 hours and discharge, isn't it? Yeah. The CDC and other countries, especially UK, US, they take it seriously. I mean, they take anything seriously. So in that manner, they would test the patient for a negative result. And then only they release it.
So we also have taken it seriously. So actually, in any other case, patient would have been discharged by now. Patient is okay. But we are keeping her just because to be on the safe side.
But this is about person-to-person transmission, sir. Now, we know in 2015, when this outbreak in South Korea happened, the main sources of person-to-person transmission is the hospital. Take our OPD setup. Like, we know how congested our OPDs are and how people mingled with each other. You know, they had to wait in the waiting area, then go to the doctor, come back to the waiting area, go to the pharmacy, and so on and so forth. So have we taken any, have we issued any directives how to organize an OPD to minimize that? I believe in the IDH, there are some provisions and there's a separate area for respiratory people. And there are ways to like minimize, like, you know, thing with each other and so on. So have we?
At present, it is easy because we don't have the transmission within the country. So it's a matter of directing these patients who are coming from abroad, who have a foreign travel within last 2 weeks with respiratory symptom to a separate desk. So it's easy. But when you get, as you said, when you get, in case if you get the virus in the country and if you're having transmission inside the country, then of course things are going to be difficult. Then we have to have a syndrome definition and direct such patients to a special corner or special room or somewhere. In the study published, what was shown was they had leukopenia and lymphopenia. But we have to take into account that these patients have come to the hospital on 7th day. So if we do it on day 2-3, we don't know what would be the, from the available data, we have no idea what would be their blood counts.
I think due to the time constraints, we need to bring this very important symposium to an end. And now I'd like to invite Dr. Anjit Pereira, who's the chairperson of the Expert Committee on Communicable Diseases, to hand over the certificate of appreciation for our resource persons who have shared very valuable information with us. Dr. Saranga Sumathipala. Dr. Sudhath Samaravira. Dr. Ananda Vichavikrama. Dr. Dilhani Samarasekara. Dr. Sapumal Dhanapala. And Dr. Indrakanta Velgam. And with that, we come to the end of a very important symposium that was conducted by SLMA. And I thank all of you for attending this very important symposium. I'd like to specially express my gratitude towards the Expert Committee on Communicable Diseases, Dr. Anjit Pereira, Dr. Lushan Jayasurya, Dr. Hasini Bannahaka, and the media committee, including Dr. Pramitha Mahanama, and other members of the committee and the SLMA. And I'd also like to thank the resource persons who have shared very valuable information with us and sharing and clarifying a lot of doubts. And very importantly, all of you, because this shows your concern and commitment towards health in the country. And few final messages, let's work together because the message was very clear. There's no need to panic and we have to work together and health, have faith on our health system and help our health system to come out with this issue. So let's work to then make sure that Sri Lanka is safe and have a great day and enjoy the rest of the day. The lunch will be available for all of you and it's provided by Hemas Pharmaceuticals. And finally, again, thank you very much.